Gildan Media proudly presents Gildan Seminars, original lectures containing essential information that can be applied to every facet of life and business. Gildan Media presents Marketing Magic, a seminar by Brian Tracy.
When I started off my speaking career some years ago, I began to produce audio programs on audio cassette. And my business was very successful for some years. And then something happened is people started to demand CDs. And I said, no, there'll always be a business for audio cassettes. So what I did is I kept pushing audio cassettes, and more people declined to buy. And then they made a big switch in automobile manufacturing and they stopped producing audio cassettes, and the business for audio cassettes disappeared. And everybody wanted and only wanted CDs. What I learned from that, and I've learned from this over the years, is that whatever got you to where you are today is not enough to keep you there. It's because the markets are changing so fast, you have to continually be questioning, am I bringing the right product to the market? Because your ability to select the right product for the right market and sell it effectively will determine your success more than any other factor. Many people are out there trying to sell a product for which the market has gone, or for which the market does not really exist. And remember that as a professional, you can sell a variety of different products and services. Your job is to find and select the right ones. Now, here's the rule. Fully 80% of products and services being consumed today are different from those that were being consumed 5 years ago. 5 years from now, 80% of the products being consumed at that time don't even exist today. The market is changing so rapidly that you have to change with it. You must be constantly looking for and selecting, developing new products and services for a fast-changing marketplace. Fortunately, there are unlimited opportunities for you to enter the marketplace with new products and services. The rule is, as long as there are human wants unsatisfied, human needs unfulfilled, there are opportunities for the creative minority, like yourself. Your job is just to find something that people want and need and are willing to pay for right away. So how do you select a product or service? Start off by realizing that you are looking for something to offer your customers that is different or better than anything else currently available. It's very hard to get people to try a new product or to switch from an existing supplier, so whatever you offer, it has to be superior in some way. Rule number one is think about it carefully before you act. Here's a rule. 99% of new business ideas don't work. 80% of products fail within 3 to 5 years. So don't be afraid to examine it very objectively, unemotionally, and be prepared to walk away rather than to get involved in a new product. Hold it at arm's length until you've asked yourself a few questions. The first question begins with self-analysis. Number one is, do you like the product yourself? All successful businesses and business people are selling products or services that they really like. I mean, their hearts are in it. They feel emotionally about it. They feel passionate about it. They respect their product. You can't sell a product just because it's a good idea or just because it has a high potential profit margin. It's got to be something that you personally like. Other than that, you just can't get the emotion necessary or develop the persistence necessary to deal with the inevitable problems and setbacks that you'll have. So the next question is, would you buy the product and use it yourself? Do you buy it and use it? Would you buy it and use it? Are you excited about its potential for improving your own life or your own work? That's really important, because unless you're personally committed to the product, your service, or service yourself, it's very hard to get other people to buy it from you. And here's a great question. Would you sell it to your mother or to your best friend? Would you sell it to your friends at your cocktail parties? Would you sell it to your colleagues? Would you eagerly pick up people that you know and respect and encourage them to buy the product or service? And if you wouldn't, then it may not be the right one for you. It's not that it's not the right or a good product or service. It just may not be the right one for you. So be selfish at the very beginning. Now, since you as a business person are employed by your customer. You know, Sam Walton once said, we have only one boss, and that's the customer, and the customer can fire us anytime he wants by buying somewhere else. So Walmart has made itself successful by constantly thinking of themselves as acting as agents for their customers who are on limited incomes. They always take the customer's point of view in looking at any product or service, and so must you. As the customer's representative, ask yourself, what does the product achieve for my customer? What does it avoid for my customer? What does it preserve for my customer? In other words, what role would my product play in the customer's life? Ask, how does the product improve your customer's life or work? Remember, all that customers want is improvement. They want to be better off as a result of using your product or service rather than before. So you always think in terms of how will this enhance and improve my customer's life in a cost-effective way. The second question, the third question you want to ask is what kind of customers will you be selling to? What kind of customers would you be selling the product to? And the fourth question is, do you or would you personally like the customers for this product or service? I've had salespeople come to me and say, you know, I love my company, I love my product, I just don't like the people that I have to sell to. I don't like them, I don't respect them, they're complaining, they're hard to get along with, and so on. I said, then you're probably in the wrong business. All successful companies and businesses love the people they sell to. They are turned on, they're excited by serving these customers. So if you don't really like the customers who would be buying this product or service, then it may not be the right product or service for you. It may not be the right match. And that's what we're looking for in selecting a product or service. So here's an exercise. Imagine hiring yourself as a management consultant on this new product or service. In fact, one of the things you can do is ask one of your friends or colleagues, or even your spouse, to act like a management consultant, called in from the outside to evaluate whether or not this is a good product or service to bring to the market. As a management consultant, you ask yourself a series of what are called objective questions, unemotional questions. You hold yourself back, cold, unemotional, don't get your emotions involved. Say, what about this? First question you might ask is there a real demand for this? Now, you like the product, you like its profit potential, but will people really buy this in sufficient quantity? And of course, the second question, is the demand large enough? In other words, once you get into the market, can you continue to sell and sell and sell? Many years ago, when the whole idea of the personal computer came up, IBM hired an outside firm of consultants to do a market assessment. And they came back and they said that the total demand for personal computers worldwide is no more than 200 to 300 units per year. This was back in the 70s. So IBM said, well, forget about it. We won't even waste our time. Then something happened. The demand actually was huge. The reason it could not be measured is because the product was not there. So Apple came out with their computer, sold 1 million copies, and IBM did a 180-degree turnaround and entered into the market. And last year, they sold 50 million personal computers worldwide, upgraded. So is there a demand? Is the demand large enough? And could you make the demand large enough? That's a good question. And finally, is the demand concentrated enough? Is the demand identifiable enough and concentrated enough so that you can effectively advertise, promote, and sell to that customer base? If your demand is spread out all over the country and there's no way to reach those people, then even if it's a great product, it's not the right product for you. So you've now asked yourself some basic questions. Now you analyze the product or service by asking more questions. First of all, what is to be sold exactly? What is the product exactly that is to be sold, defined in terms of how it enhances the life of your customers? What does it do for your customers? The second question is, to whom will it be sold? Here you have to identify your target market. You have to identify the perfect customer for your product or service. If you're selling weight loss products, it's obvious. If you're selling car accessories, it's obvious. But you've got to be clear. You've got to be able to write out a description of Sally or Harry customer, the perfect person for you to sell to. The next question you have to ask is, at what price, what will you have to charge in order for this to be profitable? Look at the marketplace and determine the price you'll have to charge based on all of the costs of bringing it to market. And of course, you know you can go broke on 100% markup. People go broke on marking 100% markup all the time because of all the hidden costs that are involved. So determine the price you'll have to charge and ask, Can you charge this price in this market? Then you have to ask, who is going to sell the product? Who is the salesperson? Who are the salespeople? Will they be sold out of your own business? Will they be sold outside your business? Will it be retail? Will it be direct selling? But who is the person who's actually going to explain the product to the customer in order to get the customer to buy? And this brings us to, how is the product to be sold? Is it going to be sold by advertising, by acquiring leads, getting people to come in, by internet promotion, radio, newspaper, and so on? And if it's going to be sold directly one-on-one, what is the sales process? How are you going to prospect, present, answer objections, close, and take the order? So determining the salesperson and the sales process is absolutely critical to the success of new products. Remember the old saying, you can't get there from here? Very often, a product or service is designed or is structured in such a way that it can't be sold. It's just too difficult to sell it. And you often find yourself with products or services like that because they're too complicated, or there's not enough margin in it to be able to hire professional salespeople. And so even though it's a great idea, it doesn't work. Now, the next question is, how is the product going to be paid for? Are you going to sell it for cash? Are you going to sell it for terms? Are you going to finance it? Are you going to take checks or MasterCard or Visa? Are you going to sell it and get the cash before you deliver? Are you going to get the cash after you deliver? Here's one of the things which I've taught people recently. It's so important, is look at your business card. Whatever your business card says, I can tell you one thing it doesn't say, is banker. It's very dangerous to be the banker for your customers. So what we encourage people to do is to sell for cash. Or if you take an order, request 50% in advance and 100% upon delivery of the order. Don't carry accounts. Now, people say, well, our customers want to pay 30, 60, 90 days. Do you know what we did when we had that? Is we'd say, I'm sorry, we're not set up for accounts receivable. We only deal with cash. They say, but we don't have the cash. Well, put it on a credit card. Give us the purchase order. It's absolutely amazing. When you demand cash and you insist there's no other way to pay it, everybody ends up paying you cash and ends up putting off the other people. So, how is your product or service going to be produced? How are you going to acquire it? How long does it take? I remember I started importing products from Japan once and I began setting up dealerships, but then I found that it took a minimum of 3 months from the time I placed the order in Japan before I could deliver to the dealership. An entire season could have passed, and it totally transformed my way of selling. I had to be able to project 3 months in advance and have the products available for the dealer when I made the sale today, but I had to order them 3 months before. So how is the product going to be produced? How is it going to be acquired? How is it going to be made available? And then, how is it going to be paid for? How are you going to get the money for the product or service? Are they going to give it to you directly? Are they going to mail it to you? Are you going to collect it upon sale? And so on. Finally, once you have sold the product, how is it going to be serviced? How is it going to be delivered? How do you get it to the customer? By mail, by UPS, by direct delivery, by installation? What is the process of delivery? I'll give you an example. I imported automobiles from Japan some years ago, and one of the things we found is that they had to come by ship to the coast. They had to be offloaded at the coast and prepared. They had to be put on trucks and transported to the dealerships, and every single part of that was a very, very complex thing. So think through the stages of delivery, from getting it from your office or the original manufacturer to you, to the customer. And finally, the last question is, how is it going to be serviced if it requires service? How is it going to be repaired if it breaks? How is it going to be guaranteed and on what terms? And how is it going to be replaced if something is wrong? What are the processes? What are your systems in place so that you don't have to make them up each time? And having answered all these, is it still a good product idea? Now, here's some additional questions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.